is. And we're going to continue this conversation about what it means to live the blessed life today. And today, as well as next week, Pastor Andy, he'll be back to continue that. Next week, we'll be talking about cultivating a heart of generosity. That's where we're going to go today, what it means to really grow to the point that our hearts desire to give and want to give. Because it's not enough just to do something out of obligation. We need to be motivated by a desire and a want to give. So that's what we're going to look at today. But before we launch into it, I just want to ask you a question by way of introduction. How many of you in the room, just raise your hand, have ever received a gift that you know beyond a shadow of a doubt when you opened it up was a re-gift? Man, some of y'all were quick to raise that hand. Now, confession is good for the soul, so how many of you are re-gifters? That's awesome. So we've all been there, experienced that at some point. Now, how about this? How many of you have ever given a gift or had somebody give one to you that as they were giving it, it was almost as like you were trying to rip it from the clutches of death itself to get it out of their hands? Like they did not want to let it go. Y'all know what I'm talking about? I still see it all the time because I've still got two little ones in my house. And when we'll have birthday parties, it may be a nephew or a friend or something like that, that as my kids are opening a present, the kid who gave it will be like, you're going to like it. You're going to like it. You want me to tell you what it is? And then they open it up and that kid will grab it and be like, let me show you how it works. You've experienced that before. See, here's the thing about both of those approaches to giving. Each of those kind of cheapen the gift. They kind of cheapen the whole idea. When you open up that package and you see a ceramic whatever it is that's been in someone's dusty attic for a long time, you just find yourself going, what? I don't get it. When someone doesn't really want to let go of the gift they're giving, it just kind of breaks down the whole point of the giving. And that's what we're going to start with today, is that there's something to be said when we come to God and we give, when we want to see to it that we cultivate a spirit of generosity, a heart of generosity. The first thing we have to address is how we give. Not just what we give. Because a lot of times that's where we stop. In our relationship with God, we stop with, well, I gave. It's not just about that. In fact, I think it's just as important the manner in which we give the gift as it is that we give the gift at all. And so today, as we're thinking with that in mind, how do I give? Pastor touched on this last week, and as he and I were talking this week, we thought it would be good to take this even a little bit further. When we're talking about this spirit of generosity and how we give, the first thing we have to understand is this. When we give, we need to give our first and our best. Everybody, look at somebody beside you, say first and say best. Okay, that was pathetic, but we'll get there eventually. So like I said, Pastor touched on this a little bit last week. All throughout Scripture, you find this principle. If you go to Exodus, you'll find passages like Exodus 23 that speak of giving the first fruits of the soil. If you go to Proverbs, you read about giving the first of the harvest so that your barns may be full. Giving the first of the vine. Over and over, we see this idea of giving God what is first and what is best. But today, we're going to look at a particular passage that really illustrates this, and we're going to try and get a little bit more of an understanding. It's in Genesis chapter 4. If you've got your Bible, you can flip there. If not, it'll be right here on the screen in a moment. But Genesis chapter 4, and starting in verse 2, we read about the first brothers. And it says, when they grew up, Abel became a what? A shepherd, while Cain cultivated the ground, a farmer. When it was time for the harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Then Abel also brought a gift, the best of the firstborn lambs from his flock. The Lord accepted Abel and his gift, but look at this. But he did not accept Cain and his gift. This made Cain very angry, and he looked dejected. Now, if we're just honest in this room, I remember growing up in the church, but this just isn't about me growing up in the church. I remember thinking, even on into ministry, that this was a very odd story. It was very strange to me that two individuals came to God to give a gift. And yet God looked at one, he looked at Abel, and he said, "That's fantastic. Thank you, Abel. That's what I want right there. Thank you so much." And then he looked at Cain and went, it's just odd. But it's only odd if you don't understand the nature of God. See, to understand what's going on in this story, we've got to dig a little bit deeper into the attributes of God, the character of God, who he is. Because here's the thing, let me just say this and stick with me before you go, blasphemer. There are some things that God can't do. It's true. There are some things that God, that just, a couple of you just went, there are some things God can't do. Let me throw this one out to you, okay? God can't change. He can't. It's not that he won't. He can't. You know why? Because he's omnipotent. He's all powerful. He's already the preeminent in all things. He is the first. He is the foremost. He is above all things. He can't get any better. See, change implies something can improve. God can't improve. So he can't change. Here's another one for you. Okay? God can't think the way that you and I think. Can't do it. It's not possible. He just can't. Now, don't get me wrong. The Bible talks about his thoughts. But when you and I think, we're thinking in order to process information and reach a conclusion. We're thinking in order to process what's been shared with us, shown to us, or told to us, and we are trying to run it through and figure things out. See, here's the thing. There's never been a moment in all of eternity that God was in the heavens in all of his glory, and he went, "You know, it just occurred to me." It's never happened. Now, the Bible does speak of God's thoughts, but it says this, his thoughts are not your thoughts. His ways are higher than your ways. So he can't think the way that we think. And then there's this. God cannot settle for second. He can't and he won't. You see, if you read the description of God in Exodus, you'll read in one place where he's actually referred to as the Lord your God, a jealous God. Now, not in the sense that you or I are jealous, because our jealousy is sinful in nature. His jealousy is a holy jealousy that says, I will not, I cannot settle for half-hearted devotion because of who I am. I'm above everything. I am in everything. I am beyond all of it. So he cannot settle for second. Now let's go back and read again about Cain and Abel's gifts. It says this, Abel also brought a gift. The what? And the what? Abel brought a gift. The first and the best. If you read before what Cain's offering was, it says, then Cain brought some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. Then Cain re-gifted something that was at the very end that he didn't want anyway and gave it to the Lord. See, here's the thing. God is not interested in your leftovers. Why? You're like, well, I want to give to the Lord. You do understand this is the same God who paves the streets with gold. I don't think he's in need of anything that you have. The very thing that you wear on rings and necklaces, he's like, yeah, let's put that on the street. He doesn't need it. But the fact is, he will not settle for second. He won't do it. He doesn't want it. You say, well, that's a little harsh. No, actually, in Malachi chapter 1, he actually said that to the people of Israel. He said, listen, see what was going on is the nation of Israel, they would come and they were bringing these gifts of lambs and all sorts of livestock that were lame, had no legs, had broken legs. And God actually said basically this. He said, listen, if you're going to keep bringing me that, let's just close the doors of the temple. Don't even bother. Why? Because God wants us to give out of a relationship with Him. And He was saying to the people of Israel, and He's saying to us today, if my relationship with you is only worth your leftovers, why bother? And the thing is, He's not asking you to do anything that He Himself hadn't already done. Because from the foundation of the very world, there was already a plan set into motion whereby God would give His what? His first and His best for us. So the question is, how are you giving? How are you giving? Are you giving your first and your best? It's not only about that, though, but when we talk about how we give, let's look at 2 Corinthians. It says this, you must each decide in your heart how much to give. There it is, relationship. See, giving when you come to God out of relationship is not about how little I can give, it's about how great He is. And don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. For listen to this, for God loves a person who what? Gives cheerfully. A person who gives cheerfully. I love that right there. I grew up in a church where the offering time involved someone singing a solo and me sitting quietly while the plate passed by unless I wanted my mother's fingernails in the back of my arm, right? Can any of you relate to that? I'm not saying it's a bad thing. It's just how we did the offering time. And I remember the first time I ever walked into a church where some guy stood up and said, we're so glad you're here. This is what's going on. And now it's time for us to give. And people were like, woo! Like the first time you came here. And I remember looking at him and going, what is wrong with you? They were like all excited about it. See, the essence of that passage right there, that God loves a person who gives cheerfully. This word right here in the Greek is the exact same word from which we get hilarious. That word is where we get the word hilarious. In our family, there is something that is known as the pop laugh or the Hicks laugh. Now, anybody who knows my family knows exactly what that means. My grandfather's name was William Hicks Hill. And so they know when we say the pop laugh or the Hicks laugh what we're talking about. But for those of you who don't, let me let you in on it, okay? My grandfather, if you got him tickled about something, it was all downhill from there. If he started laughing, he would start to kind of shake like this right here. And then if he really got torn up about it and he couldn't get it out of his mind, whatever had happened, a joke that was told, somebody that did or said something that he just found funny, he would actually start like this. And then before you know it, he would start to laugh, but it wasn't like, ha, 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 ha. It was this. It's just air pumping out of his lungs. That's all that would just... And he would laugh so hard that tears would come running down his face. And he could not stop. I actually saw my grandfather one time rolling in the floor. He was laughing so hard. And here's the thing. The reason we call it the pop laugh is because apparently it's hereditary. And I know it's hereditary because I caught my dad doing it in the last service. And I'm catching my brother starting to do it in the back of the sanctuary in this service. Which is fun. Every single one of us, my dad does it, I do it, my brother does it. Now both of our sons, all of our sons start to do it. And we will have these, it happened back at Christmas that I got tickled about something. My brother started laughing, my dad started laughing, and the whole room was nothing but this sound. Just crying, smacking our leg. He's doing it right now. He's actually doing it right now. That's fantastic. I love live illustrations. Anyway, it would happen. And everybody in the room is going, what's wrong with you? I'll tell you what was wrong with us. Hilarity. Something struck us as hilarious. Listen, that's what our giving should be. We should not come to God and say, well, you know, it's time for me to write this tithe check, so there you go, Lord, there's your portion. We should come and we should say, I get to write this month, and I'm writing this, and I'm believing that God is going to save somebody, change their eternity as a result of the gift that I give. Some child is going to come to know Jesus because of the gift that I give. Some student is going to come face to face with a God who can pick them up out of the mire and the desperation and save them because I get to give. Woohoo! For those of you that got weirded out by that, I'm just a cheerful giver. And I'm okay with that. Because that's what He loves. And out of relationship, I want for my Heavenly Father to look down and say, that brings me joy. I can't help but imagine that when I give, that my Father is up in heaven going, You say that, it's creative license, but I think He loves a cheerful, a hilarious giver because He is a God who finds joy in that. Be a cheerful giver. And when that's how we give, something amazing happens. Because it goes from how we give to what we receive. Now, let me be very clear. I want to say this. We do not give to get. That's not why we do this. It's improper motivation. It's just as much of a grievance to the heart of God to give to get as it is to give a lame offering. But it is an irrefutable fact that when we give in His grace, in His mercy, in His goodness, we do receive. And the first thing I think towards cultivating that generous heart that's so important that we receive is this. We receive a guard against greed. I heard a pastor put it this way one time. He said, honestly, the more I give, the more I find that God protects my heart against greed. The more I give, the more I realize, listen to this, how much I already have and develop a greater appreciation for it as opposed to always wanting more. The blessed life and the American dream are not the same thing. I want us to understand that. Your pastor wants you to understand that. The American dream is gain, gain, gain more. The blessed life is receive, give, receive, give, receive, give. That's what it means to be blessed. And here's the thing. Luke affirms this by recording what Jesus Himself said. You go look in Acts chapter 20. He records that Jesus said these words. It is more blessed to give than to receive. Now here's the thing. Let's not demonize that passage. Let's not make it about something that it's not. Because here's the thing. It's blessed to receive. Okay, so two of you. Okay. Here's the thing. If you come up to me after the message today, and you hand me a $100 bill, I will gladly take it in the name of Jesus. I will be very blessed by that. I will be happy. I will buy some lunch with it. I will buy some gas for my car. Thank you. That is a blessing. It's a blessing to receive, but it is more blessed to give. And see, here's the thing about that. When that is our motivation to be blessed so that we can be a blessing to someone else, everything changes. That one word alone carries so much weight. The word blessed is this word, makarios. It means blessed, but listen to this. It also means happy. If you're struggling and you're just feeling like life stinks and you're kind of depressed in all your relationships, give. Just give. Somewhere, something. Give. Happy, but listen to this, to rest in provision and favor. It is more blessed to give. It is more happy to give. It is more restful to give. There is more provision when we give. There is more favor when we give. See, this is not about getting something from the people of Upward Christian Fellowship. This is about what God has for us all. It is more blessed. And I want to live that. I want to live out what the writer of Hebrews said when he said, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has promised, I will never leave you or forsake you. You realize that promise is directly attached to money? When we just come to a place where we're content with what we have. So, not only is the first thing we receive a guard against greed, the second thing is this. We also receive supernatural blessing. I put it this way, we receive the opportunity to give more and experience God's supernatural blessing. 2 Corinthians, again, in chapter 9, speaks to that when it says this, and God is able to bless you, what? Abundantly, so that in all things, in all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. And then he says this in verse 10. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. Let's just leave that up there for a minute, because here's what I want you to catch, okay? What Paul is writing to us is this. God unlocks blessing for those who bless others. God unlocks blessing for those who realize that the money that you receive is nothing more than a tool to change the lives of others, to change their eternity. That's what it means to give. But God can't, listen to me, God can't grow a seed that's in your hand. You have to entrust it to him. See, all of us in this room, we receive an allotment. We receive fruit for our labor. Right? How many of you have a job in the room? Hopefully one or two. Okay. Some of you need to get a job. No, I'm just kidding. You receive fruit for your labor, right? And that fruit that you receive, you use it. You use it to trade for goods and services and whatever. So every single one of us in this room, when we work, we receive that fruit. And then we decide what we're going to do with that fruit. We say, okay, here's the thing. Many of us, this is where we go first. The first thing we do is, well, I got to make sure that I have a roof over my head. So I'm going to take care of the rent. I'm going to take care of the mortgage. So we place that fruit into the hands of a mortgage company, into the hands of someone who owns a property. And for some of us, we look, maybe first, maybe next, maybe last, I don't know. We look and we say, well, one day I want to be able to retire and live a life comfortably. And so we say, I'm going to take this fruit and I'm going to put it in Edward Jones' hands, okay? Right there. So investments are made and you're well taken care of. Then some of us, we go through life and we realize, man, I need a new car. My car is just busted up and old. It's like 3 years old. So I need... True story. So we're like, I need a new car. So we say, I'm going to give that to a loan company to pay for a car. So we distribute our fruit into those hands. But here's the thing. When we come to the place where we give cheerfully, where we give our first and best, our first fruit to God, something amazing happens. Because what we end up with is the opportunity to put it into hands that can do something that none of those other hands can. When we put it into God's hands, all of a sudden he takes, how many cantaloupes do I have here? Right here in my hand. One. One single cantaloupe that I have right here in my hand. But when I take it as a first fruit, I say, God, this is yours. In his hands, he breaks open what was nothing more than fruit before and all of a sudden reveals something on the inside. Seed. How many cantaloupes do I have in my hand? One. How many seeds do I have? A bunch. You're welcome to come count them afterwards if you want to, but I'm not gonna. But this is what I know. Even if every single one of these seeds only produced one cantaloupe, I'm suddenly experiencing abundance. But here's what I know about seeds. Seeds do something remarkable. These cantaloupes in particular, this is what I know. I looked it up. You can check it out if you want to. A single cantaloupe seed will not produce a cantaloupe. It will produce anywhere from 5 to 20. One seed. All because I take that first fruit and put it in the hands of someone who can do something with it that nobody else can. That's the power of how we give. That He blesses us in a supernatural way. And I understand, some of you are like, but I want to do that. I want to give like that. But hey, I don't have that much. Look at what this says. He who supplies what? To the who? It does not say, he who supplies seed to the one who promises to sow once he has some seed. It says, he who supplies seed to the one who's already in the act of sowing the seed he has. The first fruit given to God. That is the power of that supernatural blessing. And then the last thing, and I'll leave you with this. We receive a guard against greed, a supernatural blessing, but we also receive an opportunity to share. See, here's the thing. In the book of Exodus, chapter 13, we actually read as God is speaking to His people, as He's speaking to the nation of Israel, He talks about giving the firstborn male of all the livestock as a sacrifice to the Lord, as an offering to the Lord. He talks about giving the firstborn male son as a dedication to the Lord, dedicated wholly to Him. And in that story, as He's talking about the sacrifice of these animals, the offering given to God, He's saying, this, I want you to remember, is a result of the promise that I gave to you. You're acknowledging the promise. And He says this in Exodus 13, 14. And in the future, your children will ask you, what does all this mean? Then you will tell them, with the power of His mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, the place of our slavery. This ceremony will be like a mark branded on your hand or your forehead. It is a reminder that the power of the Lord's mighty hand brought you out of Egypt. Get this picture with me. A father who's a shepherd. He takes his son out with him to tend to the sheep, and he recognizes that one of his sheep is about to give birth to her very first. And she gives birth to this little lamb. And as she does, they realize it's a male. And so in the course of time, he takes that firstborn male and he offers it as a sacrifice to the Lord. Gives this to God, kills this little lamb. Imagine the thoughts going through the mind of a 7, 8, 9-year-old little boy as he watches his father do that. Imagine what he's thinking as he begins to utter the words, Dad, why did you do that? That's our livelihood. That was a perfectly healthy, good animal. Why did you do that? And then the father responds by saying, son, I wasn't always a shepherd. You see, there was a time in my past, in your grandfather's past, that we were nothing more than nameless, faceless slaves in bondage, held captivity by a wicked ruler, mocked, shamed, and ridiculed. But then God and His mighty hand rescued us. You see, here's the thing. I believe that every single time that I give, every single opportunity that I have to give to the work God is doing in His local church, to buy groceries for a mom, to take care of someone in a school setting, every time that I get the chance to give, I believe at any given moment, my little redhead or my curly-headed, blue-eyed little girl or even my 13-year-old will look at me and ask this question. Dad, why? And I can say, your daddy was not always free. Once I was a slave, held captivity by a wicked ruler. I was shamed, I was mocked, I was ridiculed. But God. Giving is not just about paying bills in a local church. Giving is a gateway to the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen.